So have you ever experienced double vision, or diplopia as the medical term, where you could be sitting with a friend and all of a sudden they split into two separate people? They could be side by side, it could be up and down, or even diagonally, and there could be real serious medical issues that could be causing that. Well, in this video, I'm gonna go over five medical causes for diplopia or double vision. Let's take a look. Hello and welcome, this is Dr. Allen here from the Dr. Eye Health Show, helping you learn all about the eyes and vision. And in this channel, you'll see us do a lot of vision product reviews around glasses and contacts, as well as educational videos just like this one. So if you're new here to the channel, hit that subscribe button down below and turn on notifications so that you don't miss any of my future videos. Now, having double vision can be very alarming and concerning. Imagine you were driving down the road and you could see one car in front of you, and all of a sudden it splits off into two of them and you're not sure which one is actually real. So yes, this can be really concerning and frightening, and there could actually be serious medical reasons for causing this. Now, certainly there are many different causes for double vision, and this short list is not every single possible cause for double vision. However, I'm just gonna go over the five main things that I'm thinking about when a person comes into the clinic experiencing some form of double vision. Number one, strabismus. Strabismus is the medical term for a kind of an eye turn, not necessarily a lazy eye, but it's where one eye usually ends up turning inward in some fashion. If this is something that's newly experienced and the brain hasn't adapted to it yet, people can actually see double vision. There's actually different types of strabismus or eye turns. You could have somebody with an eye turning inward, which we call an esotropia, or possibly an esophoria, versus somebody where the eye kicks outward, which we call an exotropia or an exophoria in some cases. Now, believe it or not, many people's eyes naturally do not rest looking straight ahead. Even though my eyes are straight right now, I actually have an eye that wants to just kind of wander and drift away, especially when I'm very tired. We can call this a decompensating phoria. And in fact, a lot of people do experience this, again, especially when they're tired or fatigued. Usually this type of diplopia doesn't last very long. It's rather intermittent, meaning it just sort of lasts for maybe a few seconds or a minute, but once you kind of realize it and blink your eyes a few times, things suddenly snap back into focus. Usually in the clinic, we can measure for some type of a strabismus or other type of phoria, or the alignment of the eyes, by doing what is called a cover test. You'll actually see the doctor ask you to focus on a single object, and then they'll cover one eye and go back and forth a few different times. And they're actually looking for eye movement at that time. And the good thing is that if someone does have strabismus, there are many different solutions for it. There are prism glasses, possibly vision therapy, and in really extreme cases, even some eye surgeries can help. Number two, thyroid eye disease. Now, I actually see a lot of people on treatment for some problem with their thyroid, and it seems to be becoming very, very common. And I've actually read a couple of different blog posts out there with people with these kind of different ideas of why that could be. In fact, if you're somebody who has a thyroid problem yourself, or if you're maybe in medical care and you have some sort of ideas of why so many people have issues with their thyroid, go ahead and comment in the section below. I'd love to hear what your thoughts are. Basically, thyroid problems stem from an autoimmune issue where your own immune cells attack your thyroid, but they also can attack the back surface of the eyes and cause the muscles around the eyes to swell. And because the orbit really doesn't have much place for those muscles to go, it actually pushes on the eyes and causes them to kind of protrude outward. And that kind of gives people this kind of bug-eyed appearance, and that's classically known as Graves' disease. And in the clinic, we actually do measure people's eyes of how they're protruding forward. You can use what's called an exophthalmometry. I know that's kind of a funny word. It sounds like all eye care terms are made up. I've actually had some friends tell me that I sound like I'm talking from a Dr. Seuss book sometimes. But the main issue with having a thyroid disease is that it can cause these muscles to swell a little bit, and it primarily is going to cause an issue with vertical double vision. So it can cause effect on all the eye muscles, but it usually affects the lower eye muscles first. So it actually causes problems with you kind of looking, and your eyes will be kind of staggered in a way, and so you'll see things kind of split vertically. But usually if somebody's experiencing new vertical double vision, I start to have at least some suspicion of thyroid eye disease, so we'll order a thyroid panel and make sure things are doing okay. Nowadays, medical professionals are pretty easy to catch thyroid issues and thyroid eye disease specifically, so it usually doesn't get to really extreme cases. However, occasionally it still happens and people will have to go under surgery for orbital decompression. Basically, they do surgery to open up the orbits so that you can actually have more space for the eyes and the eye muscles. They also do this so that the optic nerves don't get pinched, which can ultimately kill the optic nerve and therefore make you blind. But again, thankfully, we usually catch this pretty easily, and with proper treatment, you usually don't have to worry. Number 3, myasthenia gravis. Now, if you've never heard of myasthenia gravis before, it's actually another autoimmune condition where your own immune cells like block the ability for your body to really utilize acetylcholine, which is a neurotransmitter that really speaks between your muscles and your actual nerve impulses. Because of this, your own nerve impulses to move your muscles aren't really getting the signal, and so your muscles aren't really working the way they're supposed to. And one of the first signs of myasthenia gravis is typically the loss of control of the eye muscles and the eyelids. So basically, all eye doctors are trained to at least suspect myasthenia gravis whenever somebody has an eyelid droop, or also called a ptosis. Additionally, we also suspect this for anybody who's having double vision that is quite variable and usually gets worse toward the end of the day or under events of extreme fatigue. And we can test for this a couple ways in the clinic. We can use medications, we can actually do an ice pack test, we can have patients try to look up and hold their eyelids looking straight up for a while, and if they are having issues, then the muscles get tired really quickly and their lids start to sink really fast. One of the biggest concerns for myasthenia gravis is that because you can lose your ability to control your own muscles, you can actually have difficulty swallowing and potentially even breathing. And you could probably guess that not being able to breathe or swallow could be a real problem. Doctors also have to be concerned in this condition for the patient developing a tumor within their thymus called a thymoma, and it occurs about 20% of patients. Again, thankfully for this condition, we can usually identify the patient who's having this issue, we can refer them to a neurologist or a doctor who's more familiar with treating this type of disease, and usually with treatment, they do much better. 4, multiple sclerosis. Now, multiple sclerosis, or MS, can be a very frustrating disease, not only just for the patient who's actually experiencing it, but also for the doctors. MS can attack and affect people in so many different ways that it's highly variable. One person can get it, and they're only mildly affected, where another person can develop a really severe form rather quickly, and even at a younger age. MS is an autoimmune condition where basically your own body starts to attack the myelin sheath. This is the fatty sheath that surrounds all the different nerves in your body. It's basically kind of like the rubber wiring around other wires that you see for electronics. It actually helps the propagation of electrical signals down those nerves. So this can affect many different motor abilities in your body and can be very frustrating. And specifically in eye care, multiple sclerosis can present in several different ways. In fact, it's one of the big things that doctors look for, specifically when a patient's coming in with kind of any sort of vision loss or some sort of visual obscurations. They're seeing things a little bit differently. And when we examine the eye, everything looks normal. This is because MS can actually cause something called an optic neuritis, and this is where there's swelling in the back of the nerve behind the eye. And because it's behind the eye, the doctor really can't see it, but we know that with swelling of the nerve, there's these kind of typical symptoms that people will develop. People usually experience some type of blurred vision, maybe dimming of lights, loss of color vision. They could actually be experiencing pain with eye movement. So when we ask a patient if they're looking left, look right, are they experiencing a sharp pain? That could be that the optic nerve is swollen, and then when you're turning your eye, it's pulling on that nerve and you can actually feel it. Usually in these cases, we order a brain MRI to really identify that it is MS, and it's really important that we do so because the earlier we catch it, really the better the outcomes and treatments are for those patients. But since MS can affect all of your muscles, it can actually affect the eye muscles quite in an extreme manner. And just like with other conditions, it can be quite variable and pretty frustrating. So eye doctors like myself can prescribe glasses with prism in there to help orient kind of how the eye is seeing, and that can sometimes negate the double vision. So the person could be seeing double, and then we'll prescribe the prism glasses and it'll shift the images together so they're seeing single again. However, if it's highly variable and one day they're having a better day, then the prism glasses we prescribed when they're having a bad day are no longer gonna work. They're gonna almost overprescribe, so it could actually cause double vision. So sometimes these patients will have multiple sets of glasses depending on how good or bad of a day they're having. There's also some prisms that can be kind of stuck onto glasses lenses, kind of like a sticker. Those ones are pretty nice because you can just remove them and put them back on depending on really how severe the double vision is affecting you that day. Of course, for some people, the easy solution is actually just patching over one eye, because when you're having double vision due to two eyes and you patch one eye, then all of a sudden you're just monocular using one eye. Ultimately, MS can be very frustrating, not only just for the doctor again, but absolutely for the patient, and I do not wish that disease on anybody. And number five, and that is a brain tumor or mass lesion. Now, I do not like to mention anything like brain tumor to patients actually in the clinic, because it can cause a lot of fear and anxiety. But the reality in medicine and in life, these things do happen. And an eye exam is very much a neurological exam in many ways, basically because we're testing so many cranial nerves all at once. Your cranial nerve 3 involves a lot of the eye muscles, including how the pupil works. Cranial nerve 6 controls eye muscles. Cranial nerve 4 controls your eye muscles. Cranial nerve 2 is your optic nerve. And because all of these cranial nerves originate in deeper parts of the brain, they actually have long extensions that go to the eye. So if a tumor or a lesion in your brain is occurring anywhere along these nerves, it can affect the eye muscles. Actually, not too long ago, I did have a case where a woman came in. She had double vision whenever she was looking off to her left side. And just a couple of weeks before that, I had seen her for another reason and everything was normal. So I kind of had this deep sinking feeling that something bad was going on. Basically, after seeing all the different tests and checking her eye muscles, I was able to narrow down that it was cranial nerve 6 on her left side that was affecting her. I ordered a brain MRI. And basically it came back that she did have really severe hemangioma. Ultimately, at that time, things were starting to turn out for her. I honestly haven't kept up with her for a couple of years, so I don't know where she's at. I'm really hoping, though, that things turned out well for her. I think it's important that if you're ever experiencing any sort of new onset double vision and you haven't had it addressed before by your doctor, please make an eye examination with your local eye care physician so that you can get things checked out and make sure that everything's okay. Again, thankfully, with many cases of double vision, we can narrow down the cause, we can get correct treatment. If needed, we can actually prescribe glasses or have special prisms put into the glasses to basically bring things back into alignment. However, if you are being prescribed prism, understand that it can be very difficult and pretty variable depending on how you're doing that day during testing and how the glasses are made and fit. Again, if you are having issues with double vision, whether you are being treated by an eye care professional or you're just experiencing now, make sure you talk with your doctor and see if they can help you out. Hey, thanks for watching. If you got something out of this video, hit that like button for me, share it with a friend or family. Otherwise, keep an eye on it. We'll talk to you soon.